All right, so we've officially started our podcast, and that's what this video is. I just want to give a little intro. This sometimes the audio gets a little shaky, but I would highly recommend sticking through it as it clears back up. And from what I've heard from other people, that this podcast is very indicative to what the RawBrahs are all about and what our messages are, our retreats. So, and if you want the downloadable version so you can listen to it in the car or wherever, I'll put the link below this video and you can click that and download it and subscribe to our podcast and obviously subscribe to our videos if you haven't done that. And as a quick heads up, our next retreat is in Austin, Texas, October 16th through the 20th. An amazing group, and the next one right after that is in Costa Rica, the 24th through the 28th, and we got the Virgin Islands, January 2nd to the 6th. But I did want to say that Paul Reese is going to be attending the Austin retreat, so it'll be great to reunite with one of our best friends, favorite people in the world, and one of the favorite places in the world during the best time to be there. Austin in October, it's a great time to be there. Diana, should I say anything else or did I cover it all?
I think that's it.
All right, enjoy this podcast, and if you have anybody you want us to interview for our podcast, comment below. Give us your feedback. We definitely value it, even though if we don't have time to respond to you, it's good to plant seeds within us. We're open to those seeds, so plant them. Boop. And I guess I should say this is the guy that's interviewing me. His name is James Swanick from the Alpha Male Club, and he has a podcast. So this is him actually interviewing me for his podcast. But I figured, since a lot of y'all may have not seen it or heard it, here we go. And action! And one more thing, if you love this podcast, check the other ones we uploaded. Like, for instance, we did the upload of the, finally, you guys can get the full Edo Portal interview. I know a lot of people are looking for that. You have the story of the RawBrahs, Feel Good and Grow Rich with Brandon Hawk. Check out the whole podcast lineup, subscribe, and action for real this time. For real.
Hello again, everyone. James Swanick here with another episode. Wonderful to have you here. And today, we are going to be talking to a fascinating man who's going to be teaching you why you should speak before you think and come to your senses. Not think before you speak, as society tells us we should do, but why you should speak before you think. Why you should face your fears and feature your flaws. This is going to be very interesting because back in the day, I would always hide my flaws. I would never talk about them. And I always say, my life is great, it's amazing, it's incredible, everything's amazing. Even though inside I was like, I'm jealous of my friends' successes. I'm not where I want to be in business. I'm insecure. And I didn't verbalize that. And then I lost a business. In 2009, a financial crisis came, and I lost a business that I started. And I ran away to Buenos Aires, Argentina. I didn't want to talk about it because I'd set up myself to always be talking in the positive about how great my life was. But only in later years did I realize how damaging that was and how fake I felt and how unreal, not as an unreal in a complimentary sense, but as disingenuous I was. So we're going to be talking today a little bit about how to face your fears and feature your flaws and why we should be doing that. We're going to be talking to a guy called Daniel Eisenman, aka Danimal, from the RawBrahs. Now, my Australian accent's butchering that. It's actually RawBrahs.
No, that's much better. I think bras is a much more of a Australian or Hawaiian word anyway, so.
Okay. And Daniel is one of three brothers who runs retreats around the world, inspiring people to lose their mind and connect to their heart. It's self-acceptance through self-expression. We're going to learn all about that today. Daniel, or should I call you Danimal? How are you, mate? Great to have you here.
I'm stoked to be here. I'm happy we got to reconnect after meeting you in person a few months back.
Yeah, we met at the Conference for Men run by Mike Rostowski, who's been a guest on the show. Great guy. And so tell us a little bit about RawBrahs and what you do and how this all came about. You're one of three brothers who run this. So what's the point of this? Like, what are you trying to achieve in the world?
Yeah, that's a good question. We've come up with an acronym that somewhat categorizes us, radically authentic, wanderlusting brothers, redefining all health systems.
Oh, so it's a bumper sticker then.
That was one we tried to categorize ourselves with, because it seems like everyone wants to categorize you in some way or the other, whether it's based on your diet, are you a raw primal or paleo, or are you a vegan, or your fitness, are you do you do paleo, do you do P90X? There's always categories for everything. And we see ourselves as always changing and always growing and just accepting the contrast that the bigger the light, sometimes the bigger the shadow. And we do a lot of shadow exploration, if you will. We host retreats on helping people go there. You know how people sometimes say, oh, well, let's don't go there. Let's don't talk about that.
Yeah.
We go there. That's where we like to hang out at. We like to hang out outside the comfort zone, especially if that's where all the growth takes place. You know, you've heard that before.
So I was just about to ask a question, but you just kind of answered it. That's where all the growth takes place. So why do we need to talk about what we don't want to talk about?
Yeah, it's funny. It seems paradoxical, but basically we've found through experimenting with this that what's most personal is actually what's most universal. The things that we typically hide and don't talk about and kind of wipe under the rug, when we expose light to that, it connects us deeper and more meaningful than any other way than talking about the weather or talking about what happened yesterday or talking about what will happen in the future. It seems like a simple concept to act how you feel, but it's much more challenging to act how you feel and talk about right now. I challenge people to, in the future, when they find themselves in a conversation, how often do you actually talk about what's going on right now? How you're feeling? What's happening? Like, what's challenging you? What's good about your life? It's usually about things that happened in the past or trips in the future or the weather. And we just got bored of that. We've done so many different experiments with health that we found this is one what the world is starving for. The world is starving for authenticity and transparency and vulnerability.
Yeah, it's interesting. Authenticity and all those kind of words. It's so important, isn't it? Like, I used the example at the top of this at the top of the show when I was talking about how I ran away to Buenos Aires, Argentina, and it was funny, you know, because I ended up going to the spiritual mind place in Uruguay. I got a boat from Buenos Aires, Argentina, over to Montevideo in Uruguay, and then this place picked me up in a car and took me to this spiritual mind place, and I ended up staying there a week. And on the third night, they broke me down and made me cry like a little girl in front of 35 people just staring at me like this. And I'm like, I'm two-faced and I'm jealous of my friend back in LA who's earning $35,000 a week on a TV show, and his photo's up on a billboard and he's on buses that are driving by and he gets to sleep with lots of women. And I don't earn as much money as my other friend who's got this business. And, you know, I'm putting out this image of success to my friends back home in Australia. Look, here's me in a photo of Angelina Jolie, and here's me in a photo of Brad Pitt, who I used to interview because I used to be a celebrity interviewer. Isn't my life so cool? But deep down, I wasn't thinking that I was cool. You know, I was like, just wasn't happy, you know? It wasn't that I was unhappy because I was interviewing those people. It's just I wasn't really fulfilling my life's destiny, and I just didn't feel like I was a good person. And so when I actually spilled that out in front of these people and started like weeping like a little baby, it was embarrassing. It was excruciating. It was uncomfortable. But ultimately, it was the catalyst for me making real significant change in my life. And when I came back to the States, I was just so much more honest about everything. Yeah, my business failed. I lost my business. I lost $200,000 in a bad property deal in Las Vegas. I'm not really making that much money right now. Don't know what I'm doing right now. I'm a little bit lost at the moment. Not sure what I'm doing with my career. And I started saying those things. And what I found is that people started connecting to me more. They're like, oh, really? Oh, all of a sudden I was like super likable or, you know, likable to maybe a different type of person. So is that the kind of stuff that you're talking about and what you do with the RawBrahs in terms of being authentic and just coming clean and like saying what's on your mind?
Yeah, it is a lot of that, a lot of mental transparency and heart vulnerability and connecting those two. And you kind of alluded to bracing embarrassment, liberating that can be. When you think about the word emotion in themselves, it's energy in motion. And a lot of times people are only in touch with certain emotions and they suppress the rest. But as many psychologists tell you, that what you resist tends to persist.
So what you resist,
we try to create an atmosphere. Yeah, what you resist tends to persist.
Okay.
Persist. And we've just found that so true that we've come to a place where we try to, especially in retreats, we create a context that's very helpful to create this context and set boundaries. But once we do a pretty good job of basically talking about our insecurities, our jealousies, our obsessions, whatever it might be, like we talk about, like other people talk about the weather. We try to make it a light, fun conversation. And yeah, I just got jealous of you for this. And yeah, like how you spoke about your business, how you might, there might be parts of you perceiving that you were failing. But just because someone's experiencing failure or insecurity doesn't mean that they are insecure failure. It just means that's what they're experiencing in the moment. And if they can express, let what come up come out, then they can free themselves of that. So we almost celebrate people's and their jealousies. We celebrate the expression of that because they're accepting what they're going on in the moment. However, you hold that anger in or you hold those emotions in, that's when depression occurs. Depression is a suppression of emotions.
Okay.
It's holding the anger back. But depression may just be anger turned inward instead of let out.
So now I'm just gonna ask you to switch off your video. I'm gonna switch my video off because we're having a few audio issues, and we'll just continue on with audio only, if that's okay. So if you can just see that little camera there and hit stop video, and we'll just continue on with audio. So that's really interesting what you said there. It's amazing, like when you actually face those fears and you talk about it and you put it out there, it's never as bad as you think, right? It's always that moment of just before you open your mouth and you start to say what you know you should say, but you're scared of saying it. It's that moment which is the scariest part. But a lot of times when you actually just say the thing, it's not as bad as you think, right?
I couldn't agree more with that. That sometimes the real thing to fear is fear itself. That or pain, you know, the most painful part is resisting pain rather than, you know, pain is not the enemy. Denial of pain is the enemy.
So the most painful part is resisting the pain?
Yes. And we just build up these stories like, oh, I can never express that because then all that my image will be ruined, or what people think of me will be, they'll think poorly of me, or they'll think I'm insecure. And that holding that insecurity in, or holding those jealousies in, is what really haunts us. Rather than just letting it go, and you're a human being that experiences the whole gauntlet of emotions. And that's what connects us. That's what makes us human.
So I've just started watching the first season of the TV show Mad Men. I like to decompress after a night of work, and I watch about an hour of TV some nights, maybe once or twice a week. And I noticed that the main character there, Don Draper, is very successful in Manhattan in about 1959, 1960, but he's carrying this deep, dark secret with him. And I notice that character is very unhappy, even though he seems very happy on the outside, but he's very unhappy because he has this secret and he never shares it and he doesn't express it. So that's an example of someone being in pain, right? You said the most painful part is resisting the pain.
Exactly. And that's what causes it to increase.
Yeah. Okay. So don't be Don Draper from Mad Men.
yeah. I haven't seen that show, but now I'm intrigued.
Yeah. So, okay. So what you resist tends to persist. So without naming names, obviously, what are some of the things that some of the guys talk about or reveal or bring to the surface when they go on these retreats that you run?
Yeah, I appreciate you, putting that disclaimer out there, not to say anyone's name in particular, because that is part of the context that we create, that we're very keen on confidentiality, because that helps kind of create a safe space and help people feel that it won't be taken out of context. But yeah, a lot of people have, and probably things you deal with what you do and people coming to you for coaching and such, is financial shame, sexual shame, a lot of sexual shame. It's just the most common thing. A lot of addictions, whether it's addiction to a substance or addiction to control, a lot of obsessions, a lot of things that people think make them so different and so weird that they can never share it with anyone. So it kind of just eats away at their vitality. rather than finding a group of people to like make fun of it. That's exactly what we're doing. We're making fun of our problems. We're bringing light to the problems.
Okay, so when you say financial shame, like what kind of financial shame is there? Can you give me a couple of examples? Because I want to use these examples to really, so it resonates with our viewer and listener, so they can feel comfortable at least, you know, thinking about or contemplating the idea of talking about it and bringing it up with someone or with some people. So what's some specific examples of some guys' financial shame?
Well, you maybe you've been exposed to this, but even a lot of people that run companies based on business coaching, they're trying to help other people make money. We find that a lot of times that's a projection or a compensation that they're trying to learn themselves, that sometimes we tend to teach what we want to walk through, or we teach what we want to learn. And sometimes because they're help, and they really could, some people are really able to help others make money, but maybe because college debt, maybe they started $100,000 in the hole, or they're overcoming some kind of financial crisis. Maybe they lost a home or they're going through a divorce and they really are producing a lot of income, but maybe their net worth isn't much. Maybe it's even in the negative. That they tend to want to keep that secret. And sometimes instead of expressing how they feel fraudulent, they just hold that in. And I think that can slowly chip away at their effectiveness of actually helping others, because they are feeling like a fraud on the inside. So maybe projecting or conveying a character what they don't feel like. And to me, it's so refreshing to have people around that can first reveal what they typically conceal. And then you can just see a new glow to them, a new vibrancy, and then they can do their job even that much better.
And so do they reveal it to you, right? And they reveal it to the friends or to the people who are away with you on this retreat, but do they reveal it to their coaching clients?
That's a good question. We do our best at the retreats, and some people really take off with it afterwards, and then some people feel like it's just too scary. And I agree. In a lot of ways, this is a lifelong practice. Being honest is, and acting how you feel is a lifelong practice. There will always be a challenge. There's going to always be some pressure for you to be used by your ego or to make the image more important than who you actually are. But a lot of it's asking for permission, or a lot of it's creating that context. Like, hey, you know, asking someone like, hey, I went to this retreat, or I studied this book. There's a book named Radical Honesty by Brad Blanton. And, you know, kind of going over the philosophy here for a second, asking people, do you want to practice it? Maybe I can reveal the things I don't want to tell you, and then you can do it with me. And then people find out that connection is so much greater than perfection. Everyone wants to come off like as a perfect person or this great person. But what trumps that is connecting with someone over their insecurities or their challenges.
Okay. So there's an example of financial shame. Sexual shame. What do guys or people talk about in relation to sexual shame?
Oh man, that can range. A lot of it is abuse when they were younger. A lot of it, and you find actually that a lot of people that have been abused when they were younger, all of a sudden feel the urge, maybe they feel more prone to be abusive themselves. Even there was a case once, and I'm sure other psychologists, or not that I'm a psychologist, I've studied a lot, but I went to Emory University and got a biology degree and did the pre-med requisites and took the MCATs, but I stopped there. Mm-hmm. I felt like I was, I was more about becoming a doctor than actually what I was passionate about. And this communication and connecting is really what I'm passionate about. So off that tangent, we've had someone, for instance, that had the urge. When she was around children, she was a little turned on sexually. And she seemed that she could never tell anyone. That was her, you know, that was her walking to the edge, facing her fear and really expressing that. And it was amazing to see how her energy shifted afterwards. And what's really surprising, and this goes to what resist persist, is after she was able to admit that to more people in a safe environment, their urges seemed to go away.
Yeah.
But she became less prone to that, because before she had to hide it and it was something she could never talk about. So I think that kind of fuels that fire. But when she was a little more liberated and free to express like, hey, I'm like experiencing some weird feelings. It doesn't even have to make sense. Emotions don't always have to be logical. Everyone wants to make sense of how they feel. But that's why there's a difference between the mind and your emotions. And you don't have to make sense of them. Maybe the most important thing to do is just express them.
Yeah. Okay. So that was sexual shame. What about addictions to substances and control? Addictions to control.
Yeah, I think everyone's addicted to something in some way, or even you'll find that even people that are in AA that count their days of sobriety, in a way, they're now addicted to sobriety. And I think that's great. I think it's for people that weren't able to live a functional or a high vibrating life with a substance they were abusing every day. I think it's a much better switch to be addicted to sobriety. But I think we all deal with that in some way, whether it's addicted to feeling important, whether it's addicted to making a certain type of money, or whether it's addicted to a drug or a substance. That once again, that we found that when you express how you feel about it or you talk about it, the less likely you are going to do it. So if someone feels like they're so ashamed that they have a drug addiction, it's funny when you go to an AA meeting and everyone starts talking about it openly, then they kind of get their high from that instead. Mm. They get their fulfillment from that instead. And we take the other side of the coin of that as well. That if you have a really big goal that you're really serious about accomplishing, for instance, this is a random one. I recently am intrigued by free diving. And let's just say my goal was I want to free dive to 200 feet. Mm-hmm. That the more I talk about, like, I'm going to free dive to 200 feet, like, I have my goal set, I'm going to do this by this time, and like announce it publicly, the more I almost get a fulfillment of doing it, and the less likely I am to accomplish it. So the things, as counterintuitive as this sounds, we find that the things you don't want to tell people, it's more important that you do. And the things that you do want to tell people about future goals, it might be more important to hold that in and let that persistence build up until you accomplish the goal.
Okay, that's interesting. So the things you don't want to tell people, you go ahead and do them. So these are things that you want to do? Is that
Or say, for instance, if you're an alcoholic and mm-hmm. every night you find yourself drinking a handle of liquor, mm-hmm. maybe you can start finding a group of people, whether it's AA or your significant other or mm-hmm. a RawBrahs retreat, and come clean. Be like, hey, you know, like I'm so ashamed. I keep trying to escape every night. I don't want to drink alcohol, but I do. And tonight I don't want to drink it. And I just wanted to let y'all know that I have the urge to do it. Do y'all have any support for me? I feel so vulnerable. I feel so weak. And when the more they talk about it, it's more like they almost got the fulfillment. But if they're going to hide it and they keep it secret, then it's like they have to run in the closet, chug a bottle of liquor and not tell anyone about it.
Mm.
And, yeah, it's just a pattern that we keep seeing, whether it's the financial or sexual or addiction.
Yeah, so financial, sexual, and addiction. Okay, so the person who's listening to you and I speak right now maybe is thinking there's something that they want to come clean on. How does this person do it? I mean, it's one thing for he or she to listen to us, tell him or her, go and do it, just go and come clean. Face your fears, feature your flaws. It's another thing to actually do it. So how does the person actually come clean and actually do it?
All right. That's a great question. And let me start by how you don't do it. You don't do it through a text message. You don't do it through an email. You don't do it through a Facebook post. We found that, especially when you're talking about meaningful subjects, that most of the important things are said without words, that there's this nonverbal communication that takes place when you see someone, their face get all red, the blood rushes to their face or their ears, and you can see their eyes just get sad, and that you can really empathize with someone nonverbally. I actually think it's the closest thing we have to a universal language. There might even be energy exchanged in person. So I would recommend to do the best job you can of creating the context, whether that's watching some of our videos about raw honesty and authentic communication, reading books about the subject, whether it's from Brad Blanton, the Radical Honesty, or listening to different Alan Watts videos, just some, you know, great thinkers of our time and before our time that have dealt with this and have benefited greatly from it. And then you need to express it to the person that would impact the most. So basically, probably the person, if it's you had an affair with an ex-girlfriend and you've never told her, and you find yourself, so every once in a while that comes up, that we believe that sometimes those emotional blockages in the past can manifest to physical ailments, that those energy and those emotions, those energies in motion that were suppressed can actually manifest into something in our body. And I would highly encourage anyone that might be dealing with something like that to go to their ex in person if they can, at the very least on Skype. You know, with video online today, like just how you were doing a second ago, that's the very least. I would do that. And you need to go with them, tell them all the things you don't want to tell them. Tell it from the beginning to the end. Stick with your part. If you feel like crying, to let it all out and keep going. But you need to invite them to stick around for the whole time. You need to express how vulnerable this is making you. You need to say, maybe invite them to read the book, or to, can we set a time where you have a few hours where you don't have to go, because I'm going to tell you some things that are going to really scare me. And I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to handle them. And I'm not sure if you're going to be able to handle my reaction. So would you be courageous enough to sit with me through it? Because I just feel like I'm lacking, my health is lacking, or my vitality is lacking for me holding the secret. And I want to be free. I want to let go.
So.
And then you do it. And then you do it. You lose your mind and you come to your senses. It's a way of bungee. It's like we used to travel, and we still do. We travel around the world looking for thrills, spills, and action. But I've found that some of my biggest rushes and some of my most exciting moments in my life is just having an honest conversation with the person right next to me. I didn't have to travel anywhere.
So what about let's do an example here. What about the guy who's married? He's happily married. He's got two children, but he had an affair a couple years ago, cheated on his wife, had an affair that lasted a few months. Now it's over, but now he's back and he's happily married. One might argue that it's better not to bring that up. Let sleeping dogs lie. It's better not to talk to your wife and say, I got something that happened a few months ago, I want to tell you about it. Some might say, just don't ever bring it up. It happened, forget it. You're going to cause a lot of pain and suffering if you talk about it. Based on what you have seen of human nature and the breakthroughs that you've seen that people have made when they talk about their financial, sexual, and substance shame, should that man come clean with his wife, or should he not?
I personally would say yes. And I'm also, that being said, I'm someone that doesn't necessarily need to agree with people. I try to make connections based on disagreement. So many people surround themselves with people that they only agree with. But I think that we can learn so much more if we surround ourselves with people that will healthily argue with us, or will, you know, express themselves regardless of what we believe. And that being said, that I think one of the biggest traps a lot of people fall into are having someone fall in love with them or get in a relationship with a role they're playing rather than who they actually are. You see that so much. You see that maybe you have guy friends that once they leave their girlfriend or their wife, they turn into someone totally different. But I feel, there's a funny saying, maybe inspirational for some people, that let the bridges you burn light your way. Mm-hmm. That I've lost relationships for sure. I actually had an ex-girlfriend, just a funny story. And we were kind of on the rocks, especially with all my honesty. And I told her how one night I had I masturbated thinking about her mom. Her mom was pretty cute, actually.
I'm sure that went down well with her.
Yeah, and she, that was at that point, she was not she didn't like that at all. And I actually,
sure, she was like, "Ah, no problem. Thank you for sharing. I appreciate your honesty. No worries. Let's just continue our relationship."
Yeah. My theory is that she's actually very insecure because her mom is very attractive.
Of course she's very attractive. Otherwise you wouldn't be masturbating.
Yeah. And I think it's something that needs to be dealt with. I think she needs to talk to her mom that she feels jealous sometimes, that sometimes maybe she wonders if her guy friends or her boyfriends are more attracted to her mom than she is. Maybe, you know, I'm not sure. There needs to be a conversation there, because obviously you can call me fat, and you can call me all kinds of names, but I'm secure enough with my body that I'm not fat. It's not going to bother me. But if you say something, hey, Daniel, like your bow legs and you talk with a lisp and you have gray hair at the age of 29, those things will probably trigger me be a little bit more because I probably find them somewhat true. Maybe I'm a little insecure about those. So when I find that I tell someone a truth and they're extremely triggered by it, it's probably because I'm saying something that they agree in some way. And
so are you at that looking, point, it almost seems like you're trying to get a reaction from the other person. Like, I know that that's not your intent, but as you're explaining this to me, it's like one might think, well, you're just addicted. You've actually got your own addiction. Your own addiction is being so brutally honest and trying to get a reaction from someone. Does that come into it?
In a way, that is true. That is one of my addictions. I am definitely addicted to the excitement of being transparent and talking about my thoughts like I don't even believe them. You know, so many people talk about dreams or nightmares, like, yeah, I killed this guy and I had sex with this man or this woman and this happened. And they're like, it was just a dream though. But I'm sometimes wondering, maybe our dream-like state is more accurate to our reality than our awake state. And why can't we talk about our daydreams like we talk about our nightmares? Why can't we talk about our imaginations and have fun with them?
So what about when you're talking about other people? Let's just say that you go out with a couple friends and you go to a dinner, a sit-down dinner. You've been invited to some girl's birthday party and you're sitting down there and you're opposite some woman that you haven't met before. And you just think this woman's fake. Whatever happens in conversation, you just realize based on your intuition and all the work that you've done that she's fake and that you don't believe a story that she's told. And maybe it's because you picked up on her body language and you can read body language and she's just told a little lie. Now, the social setting is one of happiness. It's a birthday party. Everyone's okay. Everyone's great. People are hugging one another. Drinks are flowing. People are making new friends. In that situation, do you say, you're a fake? I think you're a fake and I feel like you're a fake and I don't believe what you said and what you just told me and you're being inauthentic. Because based on what you're saying, you should be like brutally honest all the time, right? So you then cause a scene at this party and tell this chick that she's, sorry, tell this woman, I'm saying using the terminology of chick there because you know the point I'm getting at, right? Like where is it socially acceptable and where is it not? Like tell me how you struggle or how you deal with those situations.
Yeah, I'm really happy you're bringing that up. And I mean, if you want to just have the most exciting, ridiculous life ever, yeah, go ahead and do that. That's not what we're recommending though. If this is a girl that I want to connect with, that is maybe one of my friends, maybe I feel like she could benefit from being more authentic and more congruent, I would probably invite her to the side some other time or ask her to go out for coffee one day, kind of explain the philosophy of what it is that I do and what we do and what we found through our own experimentation. And she doesn't have to believe this at all, and ask her permission. Would you want to hear like some of the things I may have picked up on? I'm not even sure if they're true. They're my imagination. They might not have nothing to do with reality, but for some reason you were reflecting something. And I found that most judgments are basically a reflection of something that you don't like about yourself or something that you want for yourself or something you just don't understand about yourself. So most of the times we have these judgments, they're a reflection on our self. But this is, and that's how I would do it. If it's someone I cared about connecting with. This is not about going to the grocery store and being like, you're fat, you're ugly, you're stupid. It's not anything like that. You can live a normal life. This is more for your intimate relationships and people you care about.
Okay, so we're talking to Daniel Eisenman. He's Danimal from the RawBrahs, and you can get him on Twitter at RawBrahs. You know, I can't pronounce it right because of this damn Australian accent.
Mate. Yeah, you got it. Yeah, I like the way you say it better.
RawBrahs, RawBrahs. It's RawBrahs. So if you want to send a tweet out, just say you're listening to at James Swanick and at RawBrahs. That's RawBrahs. That's at RawBrahs. Send a tweet out now and let us know that you're listening if you've got a comment. So as I'm interviewing you in this interview, Daniel, is there something that's come up and you've gone, James is asking me certain questions that I'm not happy with, or he's going a certain way? Like, let's do a little experiment here. So can you be honest with me and tell me what you think of this interview, how I've asked the questions. Is there anything that's upset you? Is there anything that you like? Like, give me an example of being brutally honest and dealing with that conversation with, say, a stranger or with someone who you're friendly with. I'm willing to put myself out there if you're willing to go there.
Yeah, well, it might not be the best example because so far this conversation has been pretty easy and, you know, I think you're doing a great job at it. And plus, I would probably want to be on video if you want to turn your video back. I'm not sure if that would mess up the...
We can give it a shot. Let's go back to Zoom. So let's try... Here we go. So we're turning the video back on.
Okay. And I would probably speak more about things that... Because since the conversation seems so easygoing, I could probably just talk about my judgments of you okay. as a person.
Sure.
If you really want me to.
Yeah, no, and I do. I know. I've done some of this work when we did it at the conference for men. And I talked about this and some other people gave me their judgments of me as well. So yes, I mean, it's a good test for me to be able to put myself out there and to be open to being judged, right? So I've got to walk the walk and not just talk the talk. So give it to me.
All right. Well, and I do want to put another disclaimer out there that a lot of times, just like real reality TV, that and just like you painting that picture of the party, this is not usually something I would recommend doing with an audience because then it becomes more about being right than connecting. You know what I'm saying? Like on reality TV, they have cameras and the whole world's watching. So yeah. An argument, like a small argument, turns into the biggest thing ever because everyone has to prove the whole world their point.
Yeah, yeah.
So that, but I'm happy to do the experiment just for fun as sure. an example.
Yeah.
I would probably say maybe I have a judgment about, I think this is called the alpha male club. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And maybe you get this quite a bit, or maybe you imagine it. I just think that I think it's a beta move to call yourself an alpha male.
Okay.
And, that probably reflects an insecurity in me. Cause maybe sometimes I think I'm an alpha male. Maybe I, go around acting like I'm an alpha, but in reality, maybe sometimes I don't always feel like that. Like, especially in the surf lineup today, I felt very beta. I was surfing at Ponto Beach and there was some surfers out there. I think you can always tell who an alpha is when, in the surf anyways, when the biggest wave comes, who do all the other surfers look at?
Yeah, okay.
Or at a party, the alpha male, when the hottest girl walks in, who do the other guys look at? Not that they don't look at the girl, like when they look at the girl, then which guy do they look at? That's the
yeah,
alpha male.
Yeah.
But, you know.
And we should actually just create a little bit more context on this because I know at the conference for men, we did this exercise where we were sort of telling people what we didn't like about them or something that annoyed us about them. But then you had to finish the sentence with, and what that says about me is. So yeah. It's not enough to just say, hey, James, I think that you calling this the alpha male club is a real beta move. You finished it with, hey, James, I think you calling this the alpha male club is a beta move. And what that says about me is, and I think you said, because sometimes I feel like I'm the alpha male. Sometimes I feel like I'm the beta male. So again, it's putting it in context back to you, back to the person who's projecting their thought processes, right?
Yeah, yeah. It's a great way to attach any judgment is to find out what it reflects about you, or it doesn't. What it reflects what you don't like about yourself, or what it reflects something you're not sure about yourself. We base most of our judgments based on ourselves. So, and yeah, that's true. It's probably just the alphaness. Maybe I convey an alpha character sometimes and I don't, and maybe I feel beta sometimes.
Yeah. So I should do the same exercise to you now, right?
Yeah, for sure. I'm always game for that.
Okay. So my perception of you and what you do is that it's too much putting it out there. It's too kind of like I feel like you come across as sometimes pompous, or like you know everything because you think that putting it out there and expressing yourself means that you know everything about the universe and about happiness and contentment that other people don't seem to know. And that if you do that and you are just brutally honest, that you'll solve all of the world's problems. And I get that impression from talking to you. And what that says about me is that I'm not honest enough and I don't put myself out there enough and I'm not completely open and transparent. I push myself a lot, but I know I don't push myself right to the edge like you do, and I feel that insecurity about myself.
Yeah, no, there might be some truth to what you said there, and there might not be, but I appreciate you for sharing that in the reflection.
So let's just go back
And hopefully that's a good example.
Let's just go back to audio only because we just lost it there. So just let's go back to audio only. Can you just repeat what you said there, sorry, about what I said?
Yeah, I was just saying I really appreciate you sharing that, and there might be some truth to that. You know, I'm definitely I try not to always be one to be defensive, and you know, maybe there was some truth to what you said. Then I also really appreciate how you were able to reflect that back on yourself, and maybe it was enlightening for both of us and for people listening. So I appreciate you for sharing.
Yeah. Well, thank you for giving me the opportunity. So that was a great exercise there, and I wanted to do that exercise because when I was starting to tell you how I felt uncomfortable, and was uncomfortable. But now I don't feel uncomfortable. Now I feel pretty good about it. Now I feel like you and I are like have a greater connection. Like I feel that because we've been honest with one another. And when you were telling me, you know, I think calling an alpha male club is a beta move, I actually didn't agree with you. But I did. I also didn't take offense. You know.
Yeah.
So it's interesting. You know, like it's a fascinating game, and I think you do have to be careful on how you play it. Like this is just my perception. Again, you have to know, you have to understand context. Are you at a dinner party at some girl's birthday party? Don't really get into that conversation, you know, with some other girls around. Maybe pick your time to do it, to have that conversation. So that's really important.
Yeah, I think we both agree on that part. And I'm really happy that you brought out that you disagree with me. I'm completely okay with having friendships and relationships. Like I alluded to earlier, I might be more than okay with being around people that disagree with me. I think that's where a lot of the great things in our world have taken place when people were mature enough to sit down and disagree with each other and come to a conclusion rather than only surrounding yourself with people that think the same way you do. What growth takes place then? And then I also really appreciate you for expressing how you felt uncomfortable, because that's a major part of what we do here is that we try to turn the uncomfortable into fun comfortable. And that's the big part of the losing your mind and coming to your senses, because fear and excitement on the physiological level are almost, they have the identical response. It's usually a fast heartbeat, maybe sweaty palms, maybe you feel a little choked up. But because we have different words like uncomfortable or scared, that we kind of stay away from those experiences that where a lot of growth could take place. And it's funny that, you know, some people might have so much fun dropping in on a scary wave. That was so exciting, but having a conversation about something they feel vulnerable about, that was so uncomfortable. But if you can focus on the sensations in your body, they're almost identical. So it's a way of getting high on social interactions. It's a way of getting the same rush that you do surfing or bungee jumping or skydiving, just lost in the present moment.
Yeah, great. Amazing stuff. So just before we wrap this up, we're talking to Daniel Eisenman, otherwise known as Danimal, from the RawBrahs, one of three brothers who run retreats around the world, inspiring people to lose their mind and connect to their hearts. All right. Let's just go over a couple of things that you spoke about there, Daniel. You have to face your fears and feature your flaws. Lose your mind and come to your senses. What's most personal is what is most universal. Okay. So the things that we hide, when we expose light to it, it actually connects us deeper. So how do you do that? How do you expose light to it? Be authentic. Remember the phrase, what you resist tends to persist. The most painful part is resisting that pain. Reveal what you typically conceal. This might be around financial shame, sexual shame, addiction to substances. Reveal it, shine a light on it, expose it, and the power of those insecurities and those fears will start to diminish. Make fun of the problems. Is there something weird that's going on in your life? Is there some bodily part of you that you're ashamed of? Make fun of it. Tell people, bring it to the surface. The things you don't want to tell people, tell them. Understand context, obviously. And also, it's really important, make sure you do it as you're looking at that person. As Daniel said there, make sure you get, on the very least, get on a video Skype call or FaceTime. A text, email, a Facebook post is not going to get it done. Nonverbal interaction is the closest to a universal language, as Daniel says. It really creates that context of raw authentication. Is that a word? I don't think that's a word. What is it?
It sounded good. I'm not sure though.
Raw authenticity. Create the context of raw authenticity. You mentioned there, just before we wrap this up, Alan Watts. I must admit, I've never heard of Alan Watts, but I'm going to check him out now. Alan Watts does a lot of videos, right? And there's a lot of videos on YouTube talking about raw connection.
He wrote a book. He wrote many books, but The Wisdom of Insecurity and just realizing he does a really good job of kind of conveying some clarity on the contrast of life. And it's just, it can be scary for some people that don't, you know, want to kind of stay in their bubble and to think that things are a certain way for sure. But I've always kind of intuitively resonated with the best plans being unplanned and kind of playing around in the paradoxical realm of consciousness. It's a lot of fun. I think that we have so much divine light shining on us that sometimes it produces a shadow on the inside. And in order to navigate that shadow, we have to be authentic from the inside out, live inside out as a fashion statement. Mm. And I think Alan Watts he's a real thinker and a philosopher, and he'll, for the people that are maybe more mental oriented or more mind oriented, he can really add clarity to your life.
Okay, great. Well, thank you so much.
Confusion.
What's that? Sorry?
Nothing. You just broke up for a second.
Yeah, what was that? Sorry, Daniel?
Nothing. I think we're just breaking up for a second.
Yeah, no worries at all. So Daniel from the RawBrahs, thank you so much. Where can our listener find more about you? What's the website that they can go to and connect with you on?
RawBrahs.com, which is RawBrahs.com. And then we have YouTube.com/RawBrahs, Facebook.com/RawBrahs, Instagram, and Twitter. They're all automated. All of them are .com/RawBrahs.
RawBrahs. Am I getting it right? I just can't seem to pronounce it right. RawBrahs.
RawBrahs.
Well, mate, Daniel, thank you so much. I really appreciate your time. It's been fascinating stuff. I'm going to go out into the universe and try to be more authentic, or not try. There is no try, do or do not. I'm going to be more authentic. So I really appreciate you teaching me that, and to also my listeners. Make sure you send a tweet out to Danimal right now. The Twitter handle is @RawBrahs, RawBrahs. What are you going to do? Are you going to go and have an authentic conversation? Are you going to go and have an awkward conversation? Are you going to come clean on something that's been bothering you? I want to know about it. Send me a tweet. Send Daniel a tweet. Let us know when it's done. Tell us what happened. Did you tell your girlfriend something that you didn't want to tell her? Did you admit to some kind of financial shame? Did you admit something else? Were you honest with the friend that was bothering you? We want to hear about it. Let us know. And just keep taking action, whatever you do. Daniel, thanks so much for your time, mate.
Thank you, man. I really appreciate your summary. It was right on.
All right. Thanks, man. I appreciate that. And I will catch you guys on the next one. See ya.